Good afternoon to all of you. Today my presentation is on an introduction to evolutionary computing. What are the latest evolutionary computing techniques that are available and its application, or one or two applications to water resources problems. So this gives a brief outline of this today's presentation. Brief introduction to mathematical modeling and what are the conventional tools that are available, and evolutionary computing techniques. In that, again, it is genetic algorithm, particle swarm optimization, and colony optimization. I will briefly touch all these algorithms, and then I will apply. I will also present for a few case studies, or not two case studies, and finally conclusions. Okay, coming to mathematical models, we can see that mathematical models, we are representing whatever the problem that is we have in real world in terms of a set of equations. It may be a simulation model, and we also often need to solve through optimization. So simulation, basically what we will do, we will try to generate, we will represent whatever the physical system that is taking place in the real world, that we will represent in terms of a set of equations. Then we will try to find out, if this is a input, what will be the output. That kind of simulation we will do through simulation models. And then we'll, in optimization, we'll try to find out the best alternative, whatever the possible. It may be a wide number of alternatives will be available. Then through optimization, we'll try to find out the best solutions that are possible. So it may be a minimization problems or maximization problems, or single objective, it may be a multi-objective optimization problems, or it can be combination of all these optimizations. So the most conventional technique that we see, that is calculus based techniques, that we, and mainly it is analytical techniques, where we will find, given a function y equal fx, we'll try to find out the function derivative, and then we'll equate to zero, and then we'll try to find out the stationary point, and we'll then again we'll check with the second derivative, and then we, if it is a negative value, it will be a maximization problem. Our maximum point will occur at that solution. If it is a positive value, it may be a minimization problem. So we will get a minimum solution. So these solutions, whatever the conventional analytical models that we call in calculus-based techniques, it may work perfectly for simple problems. If we have everything as, that means derivative is possible, and whatever the objective function we have directly we can get a derivative of this objective function. Then we can apply these techniques. But most of the times it may not be possible to simplify the, to that extent. So another technique, conventional technique, is gradient based technique, or we can also call it as hill climbing techniques, where given the function f, y equal fx, we'll pick a point x0. How initially it may be starting, it may be at a specified location or whatever the initial point we are choosing. Then we will try to find out the gradient of this function, whatever the objective function we have. All these are, we are talking about single objective functions, and it may not be having constraints, but if we have constraints, again we will see how we can deal it. And then we will try to find out, after computing the gradient of this function, we will move the search, whatever the iteration we want to next step, we will move in this direction, whatever this we have here, x1 equal to x0 plus alpha into f dash x0. That means f dash is our gradient of this objective function. And then we'll try to move towards the optimal point, whether it is a minimization problem, if it is a minimum point, if it is a maximization, it will be a peak point. So we'll, but again, we can see it here. If it is having the function, if it is having only global minimum or maximum, only one peak, then it can be possible to find out that point. But it, the function may have multiple peaks, so there we may not get global optimal points. So again, these kind of techniques, it may have the problems like this. And the other category of techniques, enumerative based techniques, means we will try to evaluate each and every possible alternative through, that means we'll like what we'll do in dynamic programming, we'll classify the each state variable into a number of discrete states, and then we'll try to evaluate each possible point, and a combination of points will test it, and finally we'll arrive at particular solution. That is, we call it as global optimum. But again, it is a discretization. All these problems will be there, and it may not be possible for a large scale problem where we may have more than 7 or 10. We may have more than that number of state variables. There, it may not be possible to evaluate all these alternatives. So these techniques also have the problems with computational point of view. And another optimization techniques. So it is basically random search techniques. Those are leads to a number of recent evolutionary computation techniques, where we'll test every point. Means whatever the point, where initially we may give some random point, we will choose a random point in a specified decision space, and then we'll try to find out our number of iterations or generations, what we call in the evolutionary computation. And those things, you can see that evolutionary computation techniques, so these techniques may not require the derivative of the, that means objective function, and it only what we have the objective function, that will be enough. We don't need to find out each time this derivative of this objective function. And we are trying to find, basically evolutionary computation techniques, it will be using a set of points, that is a population of points. So the same, initially itself we are giving the set of solution, we are choosing such that it will be widely distributed, or we are selecting the points over a large number of or over a wide spectrum of decision space, we are selecting some points, or we are initializing the points randomly, and then we try to search the optimal solution. There it is possible to find out, even if it is having a multiple peaks, so there is a chance to locate that whatever the global minimum or global maximum, that optimal point we can get. So this slide, which gives a brief classification of this search techniques, basically, as I told, first one is the calculus based techniques, and the enumerative techniques, that is the dynamic programming techniques, and the middle portion, what we have, this guided random search techniques, where we are incorporating whatever the knowledge or whatever the heuristics we know, that is guided into random search techniques. That means apart from random search technique, whatever the knowledge we know about the problem or about the model, we are incorporating, then we are guiding the random search technique. That means, again, we can classify in these techniques evolutionary algorithms, swarm intelligence, or etc. Again, basically evolutionary algorithms are popularly known as evolutionary techniques. In broad sense, they can classify it, starting from early 1960s or 59 sometime, they started with evolutionary strategies and evolutionary programming and genetic algorithms. These are basic algorithms that have been developed in 60s and 70s. And later on, many variations of genetic algorithms have been developed, and still they are developing. Still some lot of research is going on and finding best possible heuristics. So again, this another field of recent search techniques is swarm intelligence, where we have this. Again, it is also inspired by whatever the things that are observing in real world. That is, it may be swarm intelligence, means it is a cooperative group intelligence of the swarm. That is modeled through a set of equations or through a suitable heuristics, and then we are trying to find out use it as an optimization algorithm. So again, you can see that selecting an optimization technique to suit a particular problem, it may not be straightforward, but it needs expertise. It depends on the problem, which type of problem it is. And the choice of optimization strategy, so it is very crucial for the successful solution in the context of solution quality, also in the context of time consuming or how much time it is taking. So both these things we have to consider while selecting these optimization techniques. So there are many, I have shown many of these parameters that may influence, like type of decision variables, the type of objective function, or it is a any type of, very, it may be concave or convex or non-differentiable or differentiable, whatever the type of objective function it is, or what type of constraints it is having, whether it is an unconstrained problem or it is a constrained problem, or shape of decision space, or number of decision variables, each cost of each simulation, that means time, and whether it is having a linear or non-linear functions, that means linear constraints or linear or non-linear constraints, or objective functions also, and availability of derivatives. Also, whether it is having a single peak or multiple peaks, and all these things we can take care about while selecting this optimization, suitable optimization technique. So, coming to the topic, evolutionary computing techniques. So, the motivation is learn from nature. That is, whatever the natural behavior is model, and those things are used as computing tools in evolutionary computing. So the famous principle, that is Charles Darwin, what he has proposed in 1859 in his seminal works, that is origin of species based on natural selection, that is survival of the fittest concepts, that has been used in all these evolutionary computing techniques. That is a basic principle, but later on various modifications and whatever the convenient way to solve a particular problem, based on that they are modified or they are chosen. And so again, evolutionary computing, it is developing at various stages, and it is starting from 1960s and in 70s, genetic algorithm has been proposed in Holland by Holland, John Holland, and his students, De Jong and other researchers. So again, evolutionary computing, so as I told, it is basically in the starting 1960s or 70s, it is basically classified into evolutionary strategies, evolutionary programming, and genetic algorithms. We can see the technique, evolutionary strategy, which is a simplified version of this evolutionary computing technique, where it will have only mutation operator we'll use, and it will have only two population of two, but that means only two points at a time. Those things only will be manipulated or modified, and it is using over a number of generations, and finally resulting in optimal solutions. So it is basically used for real value parameter optimization. So the other computing technique, evolutionary programming, this is also used in machine learning context, and in 1916 is proposed by Fogel, Owen and Walsh and their group. It also uses only mutation operator, but genetic algorithms, we have both crossover and mutation operators, what we'll see it in next few slides. And again, it is having various type of parameters, whether it is a binary coding or real coding or whatever the coding we are using based on that. This is a standard version of evolutionary algorithm, where the procedure is, it is only having four steps or five steps, where we'll starting from, we'll initialize at the starting point, that is random initialization of the population or whatever the members we want. Then we'll evaluate the population, and then we'll, that is fitness function evaluation, that whatever the objective we have, based on that we'll evaluate it. And then we'll check what the termination criteria. If it is not satisfied, then we'll move step by step, until we reach a number of iterations or number of whatever the termination criteria what we have. That means here again we will do what will genetic operations or crossover or mutation, or if we have elitism, that also we will do. And we will use the selection operator where we want to, which one to select to next generations. Those things, all these things, it will be done in this loop. So again, this procedure is same for all these, whatever the algorithms that I told, evolutionary strategies, evolutionary programming, genetic algorithms, whatever the other variations of genetic algorithms, it may be a differential evolution, or it may be genetic programming, or any other variation. So as I told, genetic algorithms are basically search and optimization techniques, which are inspired by the natural selection, that is the Darwin's principle, where we have the survival of the fittest concept. And all these things, as I told, other GS operators, that means basic mechanisms are representation of the problem, that is the first step what that we need to do in this genetic algorithms. It may be a representation, it may be a binary coding where we have to select a number of parameters, and other parameters also we have to select, mutation operator and which one we have to select, and crossover operator which one to select. Or it may be having several variations of these operators, but all these operators, which one gives the best performance, that we don't know exactly. But people try to evaluate over a number of test functions or a number of practical problems that we'll face, and then we'll recommend these are the best possible alternatives to this kind of problems. So, okay, let us see first simple type of representation, that is binary coding, where we'll have a string, that means the total, we call it as string, that means whatever the decision variables we have, it may be a 1 or 2 or 10 or 20 or whatever the number of decision variables we have, we have to select substring length, or string length, it is a total, whatever the number of decision variables we have, it is a total combination of all these decision variables. But each decision variables we can code based on its accuracy, we can select the number of substring length, how many these binary variables, that is 1 0 0 0, this is a one decision variable. Here we have four decision variables, we have four substrings, and totally we have one substring. So we are encoding four parameters. The first parameter value, as we know this, first what will 1 0 0 0, this is a one decision variable. If we have, what we'll have the total, the value of this, basically what we are using only the here 1 0 digits, which represents a binary coding. Those things are, I think most of you knows. And as here you can see clearly, as it is, the coding, decoding is nothing but it is just one multiplied 2 to 4 of whatever the, which place it is having, fourth place it is have, the position is fourth place. So 2 to 4 of n minus 1, that is 4 minus 1, 2 cube into 1, that is 8. And other 2 to 0 into 2 to 4 of 2, 2 to 0 plus 0 into 2 to 4 of 1 plus 0 into 2 to 4 of 0. So all these anyway zeros, so the final quantity is 8. So like similarly parameter 2, we can have these values. So initialization of population is, as I told, we have to select the population, initial population, in such a way that it is all the members are widely distributed over the entire search space. So again, it may be requires knowing the decision space, that means each variable, range of these decision variables, if it is required to give as an initial population. So based on that, we can generate the initial population. So fitness function, what we have, objective function is the fitness function. If we have, if we are converting constraint problem into unconstrained, again we may use some penalty terms and it may be added in the fitness function. But for unconstrained problem, it is whatever the objective function we have, that is a fitness function. So again, as I told, whatever the string that what we have, and we have total, the function takes as input an individual, that is chromosome what we have. That means for binary coding, we have the chromosome representation. And then function return in whatever the input, that is the decoding. After decoding, we'll give the input to the objective function. Whatever the objective function, it will give the final numerical value. The numerical value we will use as a fitness function to evaluate whether it is a good solution or bad solution, or whether it is a fit to the next move or not, or next iteration or next generation. So these are the things we will use in selection operation. And so selection is the survival of the fittest, that is a concept of this evolutionary computing. And we will try to select the best individual. We will also try to find some of the wide spectrum of solutions. That means it may not be all the time, if we select only the best solutions, it may be converging to local optima. We also try to incorporate some other mechanisms to avoid those principles. And based on fitness function, we'll try to find out the best selection criteria to move to next generations. So it may have several variations of the selection operators, like proportional rule, where we will have only based on its fitness. If it is having a better fitness or higher fitness, it will be selected, or it will have higher chances of selecting to next generation. If it is having a worse solution or bad fitness function, it will have the less chance. That is what we will do in proportional selection. And then rank based selection, where there also we will rank the population. It is first one is directly it is having the magnitude as a quantity, that is a chance of selecting that member or point. But in rank based, slightly it is having a ranks, only some numerical value 1, 2, 3. If it is a best one, we will rank it as a 1, and based on then we will move to ranking to up to worst fitness or number of it. Again, it is a the worst fitness is having the population size, whatever we are taking, that will have this worst rank. And then other ranking is, again, this rank also, rank based selection criteria also, it will have the similar kind of problem what we will have in proportional selection. Means the best selection, best fit fitness functions will have higher chances to selecting, or sometimes most of them will be selected in next generation. So there is a chance of losing a wide spectrum of solutions. Then the other thing is tournament selection, where we'll have a subgroup, we'll classify the total population into a number of subgroups, and based on that means a tournament, each subgroup will call it as a tournament. That means in that again we'll select the best solutions for the next iteration or generation. So this is a basic one-point crossover operator which shows if we have two solutions, we first chromosome, and if select two parents, and how the children are cross, if we cross at this point, how the children are having this. See, here we have all zeros and ones and black and white. Here we can see the children are having different traits. That means having a different kind of some of the traits which is having the second parent, the child parents are sharing. So that means there is a possibility of locating the optimal solution at a different location, whatever the solution we have at current iteration. So next iteration it may be different, or based on this we can see. And mutation is basically what we will do, we will try to, whatever the after performing crossover operator, we will try to perform mutation operator in order to avoid, if there is a chance that based on mutation probability the crossover is taking, crossover probability crossover is taking place. There is sometimes if crossover if we give this 0.7 or 0.8, there is a chance that the member it may not be changing. So or other members also may not be changing. There we have the role for mutation, where we will try to alter the whatever the solution we have based on this mutation operator, we'll try to change the solution. Like what we have here, parent, we have all the ones, and if you want in C, you can see based on it is basically a simple mutation operator where we choose tossing a coin, and each time whether we need to perform mutation operator or not, we'll do that for all these genes what we have here, all these each one, all these we have. If we it is performed, we'll change the binary code 1 to 0 or 1 to 1. If it is not required, it is one same, it is remaining. Like this we'll do in mutation operator. Again, it is will mutation probability based on that we'll be performing this mutation operation. So okay, as I already talked about this selection operator, basically we'll have this first one is the proportional rule, what we have roulette wheel, like we see here, it is having the higher fitness value, so it is having a higher chance of selecting this region. And this one obviously it will have lowest probability of selecting that region. Okay, this is a simple GA flow chart where we'll have all these operations taking place, initializing population, evaluating the members, and we'll checking termination criteria, and then selection, crossover, mutation, and moving to next generation. And all these operations we'll do what we have seen in standard evolutionary computing procedure. The same procedure we have represented in flowchart manner. So same operator, we will do one point crossover, bitwise mutation, roulette field selection, random initialization. If you select, this is taken from Goldberg 1989, for a function, if it is having a maximization of x square as a function, fitness function, over a distant space of this range. And this is what, how we, so the selection operator is taking place. How the, initially we will evaluate this population after random initialization, what we will do, we'll, it is initialization, what we will do, we are binary coding, that means we have to decode. Again, we are decoding what we have seen here. Based on this representation, we are decoding and we are getting the values, numerical values. And then we are substituting these values in fitness function and then we are getting these values. That is fx equal x square. That is, x square is the 13 square, 169. Like that, we are getting all these fitness function for each member of this population. So then we are trying to find out the probability of each member. So that means whatever the fitness function it is having, the divided by total of this fitness function of all these members. That is what probability, that is chance of selecting that member. And this is a expected count, which is a have a also, which is equal to the whatever the probability it is, this member is having, divided by the average of this all these members probability. That's what it is, expected count. And this is a numerical value. If it is greater than 0.5, we have 1. That is a chance of selecting having 1. It is around 2. It is, if it is less than 0.5, we are taking a whole number. So you can see the third member is having lowest chance of selecting. And gradually, which is a worst solution, that's what here we have this fitness function. So similarly, we can see the crossover operator. The whatever the C we have seen in that chromosome earlier slides, the same crossover operator is taking place. And here, as I told, it is a single crossover operation. So at particular location only it is taking place. And based on that, we are changing the crossover offspring values or whatever the chromosome we have. Then X values and fitness function, similarly we are evaluating. And mutation operation, here we can see that the change in these values, bit values, whether it, if mutation 0, it is having 1, and sometime here, mutation operation is not taking place, so it is 1. Similarly, we will have, decode the values, and then we'll find out these fitness functions. So the termination criteria, finally we have to perform the termination, we have to check whether it is a solution is acceptable or not. So this termination criteria, it depends on individuals, or it depends on the which way we want to get the, try to find out the optimal solution. So it may be the, it may reach the best termination criteria, it may be, if we know the global optimum, whether it has reached or not, we'll check and we can directly put that. Otherwise, we can select a maximum number of iterations, 1,000 or 100, or based on its complexity of the problem. Then we'll select, this is the maximum number of generations we have to perform. Then if it is exceeding that number of generations, you can give the final, whatever the solution you have as a best solution. And sometimes we can also give a stagnation criteria, where we'll try to find out whether the solution, it is whether it is improving over a number of generations. If it is not improving, we will terminate that, this is a, whatever the solution we got. Suppose if we take a 50 number of iterations or generations, if it is not improving over 50 number of generations, so whatever the solutions we have before the 50th iteration or generation, that solution we will take it as an optimal solution. So most of the times it may be possible to find out near global optimal solutions, but it is also possible to got by local optimal solution. So it may not be guaranteed of global optimum. So alternative crossover operator, multi-point crossover operators. So we'll have the, at several places crossover taking place. And uniform crossover, it is also similar kind of operation. But here we have a number of points at each and every digit, we'll select the, choose this crossover, whether this, and see, again, what we have, evolutionary strategies and evolutionary programming, what we have seen, there is no crossover operator. But in genetic algorithms, we have that crossover and mutation, both the operators. But again, see, basically this crossover operator, it may be useful to explore the wide spectrum of solutions where the exploration is required if the population is converging at a specified location or at local optimal solutions. So there is a possibility of exploring a wide spectrum of or other regions of non-explored earlier, unexplored regions. Those things are possible by using this crossover operator. Whereas mutation operator tries to find out the solutions which are near to whatever the solutions we have at particular decision space. It will tries to find out near global optimal solution. That means it is trying to speed up the performance of these algorithms. So that means exploitation is possible with this mutation operator and exploration is possible with this crossover operator. So sometimes the elitism, what we have, we don't want to lose the best possible solution that are found at each and every generation. So we'll try to keep whatever the best solution that we have found at the current generation, we'll simply copy this solution to move, we'll keep the next generation. That means we are not disturbing the solution, but we are replacing, we are choosing it as it is. So these will be useful in sometimes there is a possibility, it also helps while crossover or mutation operation is taking place, and it is also helping to find out the best, again it is searching for a global optimal solution in the next generation. So obviously this idea will significantly improve the performance of these genetic algorithms. Okay, next topic of this presentation, what is swarm intelligence? Swarm intelligence, basically these are inspired by cooperative group intelligence of swarm. So this, if you want to define it as a precisely, swarm intelligence is a term used to describe the algorithms and distributed problem solvers which were inspired by the collective behavior of insect colonies and other animals. That means here also we have the information sharing among the swarm. That is a basic idea that we'll be using in this swarm intelligence algorithms. These are also basically optimization algorithms. Okay, first we'll see particle swarm optimization technique. So as I told, it is inspired by studies of social behavior of birds, insects and animals. The basic principle is, as we have what we have in genetic algorithms, we have that survival of the fittest as a basic principle. Here the cooperative group intelligence as a basic principle. That means slightly it is having some kind of natural evolution kind of thing, but the basic principles are slightly different. So here, what do you mean by particle swarm optimization? Means here the particle swarm optimization, it consists of position, or we'll see it in next generation, but it is a PSO is a model of social information sharing, which combines basically we'll have a group of, that what we'll call it as a population of solutions, and there we'll try to find out at each iteration we'll try to find out the best solution among this population. We also have whatever the member that particular member which have the best solution that has found in the previous iterations. Those two, that what we call private knowledge, is that each individual member that has gained the knowledge. What is the public knowledge is the knowledge that has entire group has gained over the iterations, past iterations. So both these knowledge will combine and will try to model as a PSO, particle swarm optimization algorithm. So it may try to find out the global optimal solution, but it is also, since it is a population based search technique, so there is a possibility to find out the many suboptimal solutions also. So basically particle swarm optimization, particle consists of position, that is the decision space where it is located, and it will also have the velocity, that is velocity direction, which direction to move, that direction that we call it as velocity. And other thing is what we have best position with respect to individual member and also with respect to global best, or that is private knowledge, public knowledge, what you call in earlier last slide, the same thing it represented PK, and velocity and position updating rules. These are the rules that representing this algorithm. Okay, the basic idea, again we have what we have here, the moving particles in the search space which refine their knowledge by interacting with their members and tries to find out the best possible solutions. So this is the basic idea of this algorithm. Okay, the velocity and position updating rules. Here we can see that there are three components. First one is that is what we have inertial part, that is what we have in last iteration, what we have in which direction the particle is moving. That's what it gives. That is, that means inertial part maintains the direction. The second part, which is a private based, that is what we individual member having the found out the best solution, that component, this is that component, it tries to find out, it turns toward the velocity direction towards the its best position. The third component, which tries to tilt the whatever the direction it is trying to the social part, which turns the velocity direction towards the public best. Okay, this, as I told you, this is a, what we have knowledge at earlier iteration. This is the what we have the individual best, and this is what the group, entire group has the best. These here we have the several parameters. We have here the velocity at previous iteration, and this is a some inertial component that we'll choose. The parameter is a basically parameter, inertial parameter. It will affect the how much weightage we can give to last iteration velocity direction, and this is a C1, C2, we call it as again constant parameters, as cognition parameters and social parameters, and it again have which how much weightage we can give to in the two components. And R1, R2 are basically random numbers that will generate. It may be a 0 to 1, we'll, in that range we can generate, and this is a, what we have the best position for the respective particle, and this is a, what we have at previous iteration. This is a position with respect to a global best position. And this is a position updating what we have, whatever the position that we have in the previous iteration, and this is a, what we have, new velocity that we are adding to these two, and we are getting the new position with respect to new velocity. So again, you can see here, if we want to put as, see here it may be a position, it may have the units of centimeter, but here velocity, if we call it as meter per time, or distance per time, but we can multiply with respect to a time step, we are taking it as one, we may have the same dimensions. So there is a possibility of good balance of exploration and exploitation by properly fine tuning these parameters. What we have, omega, C1, C2, these parameters will have its role while properly exploring and exploiting the search space. So this is the pseudocode of this algorithm, where we will generate initial swarm position. That is what we have done the same thing for other evolutionary computing techniques, and we'll try to generate also, we also try to initialize the velocity directions that we can choose as a random quantities at starting generation, and then we'll repeat a number of iterations for this generative, what we have the PSO operations, that we have velocity and position updating rules, and in at each iteration we'll also try to find out the fitness function. Based on that only we are judging whether it is better or bad, better or worse solution. So based on that, again we'll repeat this loop over a number of iterations and until termination criteria satisfied. The termination criteria are similar to that what we have seen in that. It may be having the maximum number of iterations has reached, or it may be it is not, if it is not improving over a number of specified number of iterations, and then we can select any number of any termination criteria. This is a one simple problem application of this algorithm, which shows basically this, if this is a function, maximization of this function z equal to x into exponential of minus x square minus y square. If this is a function, we want to maximize over a specified decision space or feasible decision space. We are selecting as decision space minus 2 to 2 and minus 2 to 3, this x variable as y variable correspondingly, and initializing this population all over this decision space. And after 10 iterations, we can see that most of the particles are moving towards which will have the best solution. Here we can see the scale of this fitness function. This is a small, and as it moves to red color, it is having the maximum value here, here this solution. As at iteration 20, we can see it is converging towards the global optimum. Finally, we'll try to find, see that all particles are converging towards the global optimal solution. So, case study. So this is a typical application to a reservoir operation problem, which is a most state of the art. Most of the studies I have applied based linear programming, dynamic programming, several variations of dynamic programming are applied and tested, whether the models, whatever the techniques that I developed, where they are working or not, where they are working properly or not, they are checked. And here typically we have this hypothetical case study. What we have the four reservoirs. In these four reservoirs, we have the power production from at all these, that is powerhouses we have at all these four reservoirs. Apart from wait, fourth reservoir, apart from this power production, we also have the irrigation as a another purpose of this reservoir. So what we have this, we have to maximize the benefits of from whatever the system that we have a four reservoir system, we want to maximize the benefits, overall benefit from this system. So the system dynamic equations, we can represent what we have, the mass balance equations, like for all these four reservoirs. Basically, this is a storage at T plus one period, that is a time period. T is the time period, this is the inflows, and this is the release. And we have to, for all these reservoirs, we have this system dynamic equation, that is a basically mass balance equations. And we have the, what we initially, we may have storage, initial storage for all these reservoirs. That is, that's what it, this vector represents. And this is a, we also have constraint, or we also want to desire, that is the end of storage should be this much. First reservoir, second reservoir, third reservoir, fourth reservoir. And subject to a number of constraints. The first four constraints are subject to reservoir storage, and the second four constraints are subject to reservoir release. Or which should be within this limit, but within these limits, we want to maximize the benefit. We have the benefit here, maximize the benefit from releases made to power production and irrigation from all these four reservoirs. And which way, if we release, it will have the best performance. That's what this objective function. This is for four reservoirs, hydropower production for 12 time periods. And this is a benefit from this release for irrigation purpose. That's what for single one reservoir here. And we, if we want to use the constraint method, it is a constraint problem. So we can use a simple penalty function approach to solve this, to make it to unconstrained problem. And then we can have this same fitness function and we can use it. But again, we can go for several variations of these constraint handling methods, and those things are also possible. Okay, similarly what we have here. This is what we have, this problem. This is the same what we have shown in the pseudocode, the same thing. But additionally, what we have here, reservoir operation model is a, we are using it for fitness function evaluation. That's what we are interested. The code is same for this PSO algorithm, but additionally we are using a simulation for simulation model for reservoir operation problem. And then we are trying to find out the best possible solution using particle swarm optimization algorithm. And application of PSO, so these are the total, as I told, it is having 48 decision variables from all these four reservoirs. Or basically it is having 12 time periods, and each reservoir having release, that is 48. And these are the solutions which are compared, basically particle swarm optimization, genetic algorithm, and some variation of this basic PSO algorithm is that is developed by ourselves, Nagesh Kumar and myself, and this algorithm, and we compared that performance of with all these algorithms, and these are the release policies that have been obtained, and these are the performance comparison what we have. Basically, this is a dynamic programming variation that is given in Larson. That is a that's what source of this hypothetical case study, and some other technique variation of discrete differential dynamic programming. That is Heider. He also find out the best possible solution, but he has tried so many iterations. That is again the dynamic programming. It needs a initial input as a solution. That initial solution we have to give somewhere. But it may not find all the time. It may not find the global optimal solution. But luckily, he got the with some initialization, and that he has shown here. And fully dynamic programming and particle sum optimization, genetic algorithm, YEM. So here, the PSO basic PSO has having some near global optimal achieving near global optimal solution. This much number of functional evaluations. And GA is taking quite high number of functional evaluations, and EMPSO it is taking less number of functional as compared to these two, but it is trying, it is giving the best global optimal solution what we have there. So advantage of this algorithm, as I told, it works only with objective function, so we don't require gradient of this gradient information, such kind of thing. And it may try to overcome the global optimal, local optimal solutions. So that may be an advantage over a traditional optimization technique. And PSO uses subjective function information, that's what we have. And PSO is a kind of stochastic search algorithm that can search a complicated and uncertain area by using this exploration and exploitation mechanisms of these PSO parameters or PSO updating rules. So we also seen it is our genetic algorithm also, it is having faster convergence towards the global optimal solutions as compared to genetic algorithms. Since we are incorporating some more heuristic that we have in this algorithm, so it is resulting in faster convergence. So this is also again, sometimes if it is a complicated problem, it may be a problem with respect to this algorithm. That means it may be caught by local optima or near global optimal solutions. Okay, the another technique that we want to present it, anti-collision optimization algorithm. Okay, this algorithm basically it is also classified under swarm intelligence technique, but again it is a population based search technique for the solution of complex combinatorial discrete optimization problems. So this is the best suitable for discrete, that means what we have the traveling salesman problem or assignment problems what we have, those such kind of problems, that means discrete variables, for that it is suitable. The basic concept of this ACO is cooperative search behavior of real ants in their search for food. The similar kind of behavior we'll model through some kind of mathematical equations. That means the principle here, we can see that if these are the ants, then if we are at H is a nest, if there is an obstruction in between and there is a food at this point F, at iteration t equal 0, they are trying to move randomly in both the directions. At some point of time or iteration, next iteration, which that path which is having, this is basically path tracking mechanism where we have this shortest path which will have, obviously it will reach the food source fast and then they will try to come back quickly, and iteration we can see that. And again we can see that there is a, these ants, they will deposit a trait called pheromone, that is they will have some chemical deposit that they will deposit while moving in their path. So that mechanism has been used in this ant colony optimization. That means the pheromone, it is as ants move, more and more ants move, the more and more chemical deposits in their path. So that path, it helps to next time some other ants will follow that path, or there is a higher chance to follow that path which will have. So those principles have been modeled in this ant colony optimization. So what we required in this, it is not a straightforward thing. It requires some mechanisms to adapt this SCTWRM algorithm to solve any problem. It may be a water resource problem, it may be a industrial engineering problem or whatever it is. But here what we need an appropriate representation of the problem as a graph or a similar source that is easy, that can be easily covered by hands. What we have this similar path tracking kind of thing, we need to have some kind of representation. So again, what we have here, selection of heuristic information. Whatever the problem domain knowledge that we have, that information we have to give as heuristic information to this algorithm. And those mathematics we'll see it in next slides. And we also requires a fitness function, as it is clear from other algorithms also, what we seen for evolutionary computing methods or particle sum optimization methods. We need a fitness function that we obviously will get from the whatever the problem we have. And selection of proper Feynman updating rules that we'll anyway it requires for ANTS modeling, SCTWRM modeling. So here we model it for reservoir operation problem, where the problem is approached by considering a time series of inflow, classifying the reservoir volume into several intervals. That means we are classifying the here we have, this is a we have classified into a number of discrete range intervals. The whatever the if we have 0 to 1000, we can classify into a number of intervals, and that's what it is representing, storage volume classes. And again, it is a, we have to operate at a number of time periods. That means it is a yearly operation or a monthly yearly operation or seasonally operation. It may be a monthly operation or it is a 10-day operation or a daily operation, whatever we have. That is a time period that we have. And we are classifying the reservoir volume and into several intervals and deciding reservoir release for each period with respect to an optimality criterion that we have, what we have, fitness function or objective function, what we have. And here, how we will represent the, it is similar to the SCTWRM, the links between initial and final storage volumes at different periods form a graph which represents the system and determine the release at that period. That means if we have the at time period T, if the ANT is here, to move to next step, it may move any direction, any interval or any discrete value. That initial minus final minus initial, it will be change in storage, it will give that how much volume has taken for release or whatever the losses that we have. Those things we'll be using. That is a representation of the problem. And the other principles, what we required, we require to model that if this is an ANT is at storage class 2, it can have, which can move for any storage class in the next time step, and how it is selecting based on this rule, we can model this selection of this path. That means this is a basically argument what we have maximize, that is L belongs to allowed key. Allowed key means based on our heuristic knowledge, again we can restrict to a specified number of whatever the possible region that we have, based on that we can restrict. That is a allowable key, that is allowable storage classes. This is a tau is a that is what we have, the Feynman value. This eta is the heuristic information that what we know about the problem. If we here the problem is, if we want to, we can minimize our deviations here. We'll see it next slide. Okay, here the heuristic information, it can be here what we have seen here, the deviation between the release and the demand, you want to minimize that. That we are using as heuristic information for this algorithm. And again, this tau is a, basically it is a Feynman deposit, or a, that is what we call Feynman trail value, that we have Feynman trail value updating here. This is a at next time step, what we have at previous or current time step, and this is a change in Feynman trail value based on this path tracking, how many ants move in that path, based on that magnitude it will be changing. This, that means the solution quality, here you can see that change in Feynman value is given by this. This G is a basically fitness function which is with respect to global or which one is having a better fitness among these, whatever the population we have. Among them, it is the best solution. Based on that, we are changing this fitness value. And it may have the, sometimes it, we may use different variations of this Furuman trail updating rules. Sometimes it may be local updating and sometimes it may be global updating. Those two principles also we can use. And this transition probability where we'll use, here the same thing. This is the argument if it is satisfied. This is a Q, Q naught is the parameters. Q is the some parameter that we'll choose, pre-specified parameter. Q is a some random number that we'll generate and then we'll test it this, whether we want to select with this function or we want to select this function. This is basically J is a node that is chosen based on this transition probability what we have here. This is a, again we have the same terms, Furuman trail value, and this is a heuristic information at that particular time path. But here that all these possible paths, that is, that's what it gives. This allowable paths, that is possible paths, it is, this is what, and this is what gives for this transition probability. Again, this transition probability, again, we can select based on the standard procedure. So as I told, this is also having the standard steps like initialization of the population and initialization of pyramid and other parameters that we require in this algorithm that we'll initialize, and then we'll construct the solution. What we have the, again, whatever the problem we have represented, based on that, we'll position each end in a starting node. Then for each end, we'll do the computations. That means we'll compute the heuristic information and we'll choose the next node by using the state transition rule that what we have seen it in a previous slide, that is, selecting based on transition probability or based on this argument. Based on that, we'll try to select into next time step and then we'll repeat for all the ends and we'll try to find the fitness value after performing for completing one cycle for end. And then we'll update the Furuman trail value based on this, based on the fitness function, and we'll apply the whether if it is a required local updating of Furuman trail, we'll apply. Whether if it is required only this global updating Furuman trail value, we'll apply that. And we'll try to update this Furuman trail value by adding those to the previous iteration. What we have this equation, we'll try to update this. And finally, we'll check the termination criteria. And if it is satisfied, we'll whatever the solution we find, that we will take it as a best possible solution. And this is applied for a case study of irrigation reservoir operation, which is basically solves for flood control, irrigation, and power generation, and also for drinking purpose. That also is purpose, but it is a small quantity as compared to this reservoir storage. It is a very small quantity, negligible value. So in this model, it is neglected, and that there are two powerhouses here and here. What is and the objective function is the minimize the deviation for whatever the demands we have for power production we want to minimize. Other constraints are handled by putting as other objectives are handled whatever the purpose we have, irrigation and other flood control, that are put it as constraints, and then we make it convert it into single object optimization and we solved it. Okay, we applied both the anti-collision optimization genetic algorithm models, and we also seen that this anti-collision optimization is performing better for a large scale problem. That means if it is having a short term reservoir operation problem, it is similar kind of performance we can find. But it is having a large scale, means at a time for planning purpose we may need that we can operate or we can find the starting policies or reservoir operation policies by optimizing over a large number of time origin. That means it may be 10 years we can optimize at a time. If these are the possible inflows and how best we can utilize among all these time periods. So that's what we find this anti-collision optimization is giving better results. And we can adopt this evolutionary computer techniques to multi-object optimization, where we have to, in a better way we can optimize as compared to any conventional modeling or conventional optimization techniques, these are basically having population based search techniques. So they will give some advantages while opting for generating alternative Pareto optimal solution that what we have, okay, basically here we can see a multi-objective problem where we want to maximize or minimize k number of objectives within a restricted search space or decision space what we have. And it may be subject to a number of constraints. It may be equality constraints or inequality constraints, but we want to optimize k number of objective functions. And basically we may not find the single solution as the best possible solution. We can only perform what are the best possible alternatives that are possible for with respect to all these objective functions. So the best principle that proposed is Pareto optimal principles. That is proposed long time back in 1857 or sometime. And where we Pareto optimal solution can define as a point X dot belongs to feasible search space is a Pareto optimal solution if there does not exist any feasible point X belongs to F such that one solution is dominating that particular solution. Then we are calling it as non-dominated solution. That's what we are calling. It is a Pareto optimal solution. So it has to satisfy both these two conditions. It should be at least as good as other solution, or it should not dominate. So that means at least for one objective, it is better solution. Then we are calling it as a non-dominated solution. So these are the basic conventional approaches that have been used in the past, and weighted sum method, constraint method, gold program method, and several other methods are there. And here what we have, if it is a two objective function, what we have here, this is what Pareto optimal solutions, or Pareto optimal front, what we call. What we weighted sum approach, what we will get at each time, we may give some weightage to this objective function and second objective function. And then we'll try to find out one solution at a time. And if we want to get a large number of alternatives, we have to repeat this changing weightage and finding the optimal solution. And we may get like this several points. But the problems, again, what we may face, the non-convex objective function will be there. So there we may not find exact how much weightage we may give, or how much things we can find out. But again, it may have disconnected objective space. Sometimes it may have irregular object, or disconnect means it may not be as smooth as what we have seen it here. It may have some zigzag kind of thing. So there it may not be possible to find out a smooth curve using these conventional techniques. And obviously it requires many simulation runs. So this, what we have seen evolutionary computer techniques as population-based search techniques, which at each generation they are finding several number of optimal solution or suboptimal solutions. Those principles we can use to generate a better Pareto optimal front. That means at each generation in a single run we are trying to find out a number of solutions which are non-dominated solution. That's what we'll do in multi-objective evolution algorithms. Here the MOS deals simultaneously with multiple solutions. That's what advantage of this population of solutions. And which can find several trade-off solutions in a single run of the algorithm instead of a series of separate runs as in the case of traditional optimization, that is giving the flexibility. MOS are less susceptible to structural forms of solutions. That means what we have, the disconnected Pareto front, such kind of thing, or non-convex, whatever the objective function we have. So there is this is the problem with the conventional technique. So this will give some confidence that we'll trying to find out whatever the model that is giving the solutions, so it is having a better chance of finding the non-dominated solution. That will give the confidence. And MOS attempt to find the solution to extremely complex, time-consuming real-world application. What we may not approximate the whatever the real-world problems that are taking place, it may not be possible to use a conventional modeling techniques. But we can use some a set of equations. We can simulate the model, and we can put into evolutionary algorithms, and we can find the solution to these problems. So that gives feasibility for the problem that I have given. And as MOUs, so use little problem domain knowledge and can generate a good distribution of diverse solutions. And MOUs also have the implicit parallelism. What we can use, if it is a complicated problem or it is a time-consuming problem, we can simultaneously use several computers to evaluate the fitness function or whatever the simulation model that we have. We can run it in several computers and we can use MOUs to find out the multiple Pareto optimal solutions. So these are the some of the LTIST MOUs, strength Pareto evolutionary algorithm, Pareto archive evolutionary strategies, non-dominated sorting genetic algorithms. And also we propose some multi-object to particle sum optimization algorithms, and etc. There are several variations are there. So there is a wide scope of research for this MOUs application, or also in development of this, improving the performance of these multi-object evolution algorithms. And also it is having wider applications in any field. It may be a civil engineering field or mechanical engineering or whatever the field we have taken. So that's what I have. Thank you.